You shall observe the festival of harvest, of the first fruits of your labor, of what you sow in the field. You shall observe the festival of ingathering at the end of the year, when you gather in from the field the fruit of your labor. O God, be not far from us.
Come quickly to help us, O God.
Christ has shown forth his glory.
O come, let us worship.
Glory to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Christ, mighty Savior, light of all creation, you make the daytime radiant with sunlight and to the night give glittering adornment. Stars in the heavens.
Now comes the day's end as the sun is setting. Mirror of daybreak, pledge of resurrection, while in the heavens choirs of stars appearing, hallow the nightfall.
Therefore we come now, evening rites to offer, joyfully chanting holy hymns to praise you, with all creation joining hearts and voices, singing your glory.
Give heed, we pray you, to our supplication, that you may grant us pardon for offenses, strength for our weak hearts, rest for aching bodies, soothing the weary.
Though bodies slumber, hearts shall keep their vigil, forever resting in the peace of Jesus, in the light of darkness, worshiping our Savior now and forever. Good evening and welcome. I am the Reverend Anne-Marie Nicklin, currently the priest at St. Thomas Anglican Church Wainwright and St. Mary's Anglican Church in Edgerton. And this is our weekly online service. This is my husband, Owen Nicklin.
Hello.
Who has joined me throughout to help me with these services. I apologize for there not being a service last week. Unfortunately, due to some stuff that was going on, it just wasn't possible to find an evening where I could put one together. This week's service is a celebration of Lammastide, Lammas Day. Lammas Day is actually August the 1st. So at both St. Thomas and St. Mary's on Sunday, we celebrated the presentation of the Lammas loaf, which we will also do tonight, as well as have some prayers around that. So we begin with the presentation of the Lammas loaf, which, giving thanks to Owen for having prepared it. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the people of God in ancient times presented to the Lord an offering of first fruits as a sign of their dependence upon God for their daily bread. At this Lammas time, we bring our newly baked loaf as our offering in thanksgiving to God for his faithfulness. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Those who come to me shall never be hungry. Those who believe in me shall never thirst." Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. You bring forth bread from the fields and give us the fruits of the earth in their seasons.
Accept this loaf, which we bring before you, made from the harvest of your goodness. Let it be for us a sign of your fatherly care.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, worthy of our thanksgiving and praise.
Blessed be God forever.
And our first hymn is a Lammastide carol. The credits for it come at the end of the carol.
In the fullness of the summertime, grapes are ripening on the vine. The Now the Lammas bread is given. Now the wood has made the wine. God has opened nature's door. On a hillside of the Galilee, hungry people gathered. Bread and wine aplenty, peace and fellowship divine in the presence of the Lord. Jesus Christ, the Son of Mary, bread of heaven, living true, bringing Shepherd of his people, gave his life to save us all from the shadows at the door. Now 2,000 years have come and gone, countless millions honor his name. Bread is together proclaim joy and healing to the nations. Darkness yields to life again at his table evermore.
So our psalm this evening is Psalm 104. You send the springs into the valleys.
They flow between the mountains.
And the beasts of the field drink their fill from them.
And the wild asses quench their thirst.
Beside them the birds of the air make their nests.
And sing among the branches.
You water the mountains from your dwelling on high.
The earth is fully satisfied by the fruit of your works.
You make grass grow for flocks and herds, and plants to serve human beings.
That they may bring forth food from the earth.
Wine to gladden our hearts. Oil to make a cheerful countenance.
And bread to strengthen the heart.
Glory to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and it will be forever. Amen.
So our first reading is taken from Exodus, chapter 16. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned.
Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
You are precious in my sight, and I love you. Do not fear, for I am with you.
Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. So our second reading is taken from 2 Corinthians, starting chapter 9. The point is this. The one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion. For God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. And my spirit exalts in God my Savior. For he has known mercy on my Lord. And my name will be forever exalted. For the mighty God has done great things for me, and his mercies will reach from age to age.
Our next hymn is "We'll Worship the King."
Oh.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So they said to Jesus, "What can we do to accomplish the works of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in the one he sent." So they said to him, "What sign can you do that we may see and believe in you? What can you do? Our ancestors ate manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." So Jesus said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave the bread from heaven. My Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." So they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
So while I was doing the announcements, I knew there was something more I wanted to say than what I was saying, and remembered it, of course, right after I was moving on in the service. So normally we would be doing this at St. Mary's, and I apologize for the fact that we are not in the church building of St. Mary's with that beautiful stained glass window behind us. Unfortunately, during this past week, Owen and I have come in contact with someone who may have COVID. We don't think they do. But until we can find out for sure whether or not they have it and then go and be tested ourselves, we are self-isolating at home. And that means that we can't get out to St. Mary's. And so we're back at our home venue. To the gospel reading today from chapter 6 of the Gospel of John, commonly known as the Bread of Life Discourse, rather appropriate for this time of Lammas, the presenting of the first loaf of bread of the season. In order to more fully understand some of the stuff that's coming out in this passage, we need to understand what has gone on before. So at the end of chapter 5 of John's Gospel, Jesus tells the people that Moses wrote about him. And if they believe what Moses said, then they should believe in Jesus and what Jesus says. And so right after that, we have the feeding of the 5,000. And then we have Jesus sending his disciples across the Sea of Galilee to Capernaum, because we, in the passage today, we are now in Capernaum. But he sends them across in their boat, which leaves him with no boat to get across the lake. And so he walks across. And for those of us that are very familiar with the story of Exodus, especially around Moses, We, of course, heard that bit about the feeding with the manna in the wilderness, where the people complained bitterly that they didn't have anything to eat, and God supplies them with manna. The other part of another part of that story, actually earlier on, is when it's the Passover, Moses leads the people through the Red Sea on dry land. And so at the end of chapter 5, we have that reference to Moses and the writing of Moses. Then we have the feeding of the 5,000, bringing to mind the manna that God has provided the people for in the wilderness. And then we have the walking across the sea, which reminds us of the Israelites going through the Red Sea on dry land. So we're solidly rooted in the story, the salvation story of the Israelites. There is another aspect to that, and that is the fact that Moses gave the Torah. God gave the Torah to Moses. God put the Ten Commandments on the tablets. Moses brought them down off the mountain, gave them to the people. Another word for Torah is bread. Bread is also known as the Word of God, the wisdom of God, which at the beginning of John's Gospel we hear in the prologue. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We read that late on Christmas Eve or our Christmas Day. That is our Gospel passage. And so we're becoming very steeped in the tradition, the salvation history of the Israelites and of Christianity as we read through this passage. As Christians, we relive the story of the salvation of God acting within human history every Sunday. And for Anglicans, and especially Anglicans at St. Thomas and St. Mary's, in normal times, or pre, post, whatever, normal times from before, we celebrated the Eucharist every Sunday, and at St. Thomas we're back at that, and joyfully at St. Mary's on Sunday we were able to celebrate the Eucharist outside with all the appropriate protocols available to us. Every time we approach the altar, to some extent we relive God's acts of salvation throughout all of history, in the Exodus with the Jewish people, in the story of the incarnation with our own tradition. We relive it. God created us to be physical. We cannot just exist on spiritual. Spiritual is very important, and there are unique individuals, very well gifted individuals who can live on the spiritual. But for many of us, we are totally embodied, and we need the physical, we need the tangible. And each time that we celebrate the Eucharist, each time we come together to worship, we're given that opportunity to have that tangible. And so each time that we approach an altar on a Sunday, we are offered forgiveness and acceptance and wholeness. It's not something that we have to work towards. It's not something that we are coerced to accept. It's offered to us as gift. And in approaching the altar, we are opening ourselves to receive that gift openly, fully, and joyfully. And each of us experiences the reception of that gift, the intaking of that gift, in a different way. There's not necessarily any one way that we need to do that. We relive the story of promise and of hope. But to some extent, sometimes things can almost seem to be too much for us, and we're a little bit afraid to hope. And we experience this in our lives when things are going really well, and we're just kind of thinking, okay, life is going so good right now. What's going to happen? When is that other shoe going to fall and life is going to take a dramatic turn for the worse? I'm sure that many of us have had those thoughts at a time when we should just be openly rejoicing. But it is almost a natural human trait that we need something to hold on to. We want something concrete. And that's what the people in today's gospel are doing when they ask Jesus to give them a sign. They're saying, we want something. Okay, we're willing to follow you. We're willing to hear what you have to say. But could you please give us something to hold on to? Something that we know for sure that this is the way. And I think there again, many of us have also experienced that as we follow Jesus, we sometimes wonder, are we getting the message right? God, can you please give us a concrete sign to know that what we're doing is right? And Jesus goes into that bit about, I am the bread of life. I'm going to go back just a teeny bit to approaching the altar before I move into that promise and that need for tangible. When we approach the altar, something happens that's totally countercultural. There's something that goes against what society teaches us. We approach the altar conscious of our own lacking in some ways, of having lived life as we were supposed to, life as God calls us to live, life as Jesus has taught us to live. We approach knowing that there's something lacking. Now in society, when we mess up, when we do something that society does not think is good, there is a punishment for it. There are consequences that are followed, and it usually in today's system is a form of punishment. God is totally countercultural. The form, this idea that if you do something wrong, you must be punished, is more of a Latin understanding of justice. God works in a different way. So that when we approach the altar, knowing of our brokenness, although we will have just said the confession and received forgiveness, but we do approach the altar knowing our brokenness. And instead of judgment, we find mercy. Instead of justice, we find love. And I just want to look at that idea of justice. I mentioned that society's idea of justice is more of a Latin sense of justice, where you must be punished. Whereas God's sense of justice is, or the Hebrew sense of justice, is a sense of restorative justice, where we try as much as possible, where God tries to restore things to what they were originally meant to be. Which in the Anglican Church, when we look at a reconciliation of a penitent and somebody comes for confession, that is one of the emphasis that we try to put onto it, is that restoration. How can we bring things back to as much as close as possible to the ways that they were meant to be? So God reaches out to us, and instead of meeting us with punishing judgment, meets us with love, calling us back, calling us to restore things as much as possible to the way that they are meant to be, and ourselves as much as possible to the way that we are meant to be. Instead of condemnation, God meets us with forgiveness. And we see that most clearly in Luke's gospel in the parable of the prodigal son. For the Jewish people of the time, the ones that were awaiting a Messiah, they were awaiting a Messiah that would come in glory and might and power. And God didn't do that. God came in weakness. God came as a wee baby in weakness. Lived life as basically a peasant, not in the halls of power, not in the hierarchy of the religion of the time, but rather as a peasant, a carpenter. Came in weakness. And I think that one of the reasons this is so powerful is that if God had come in the halls of power, we might be tempted to follow God or follow Jesus just because of the power and influence Jesus had. We might feel coerced that we have to follow because here is a person of power and might, and we are relatively trained to follow a person of power and might. In coming in weakness, God allows us to freely choose to follow God, to follow Jesus, to follow the way that Jesus taught us. God allows us to freely choose that with an open and a whole heart. And when we choose for the right reasons. We're not choosing because we want power and influence. We're not choosing because we feel forced to choose. Rather, we're choosing because we recognize the life that is available in there. We recognize the rightness in what Jesus has to teach us. So rather than coming in power, God comes in weakness. Now, if you remember in the gospel, the people asked for a sign. They wanted a miracle, even though they just experienced the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. They wanted something more to hold onto. And God doesn't give a miracle. And Jesus reminds the people of this. John, the writer of John's gospel, reminds the community to whom John is writing that rather than giving a miracle, God gave us God's self in the person of Jesus. That self-emptying, that reaching out and being with us, right to the point of giving up the very life on the cross. Instead of a miracle, we got something much greater. In all of this, we are shown that God so desperately loves us, that God is willing to go to extreme lengths to draw us into that love, to help us open ourselves and to receive that love. And so God comes in the person of Jesus, offering us the bread of life, offering us the gift of grace, offering us that abundance that the scriptures speak about and that so many people before us have found in following the pathway that Jesus has laid out for us. So when Jesus says, I am the bread of life, those who come to me will never hunger, we recognize that in Jesus, all our needs are met. That in Jesus, we find a way of life that gives us a fullness, a wholeness, and an acceptance that we cannot experience anywhere else. And so we continue our worship with the profession of our faith. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. And our next hymn is We Plow the Fields and Scatter.
We plow the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the harvest when the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, the soft refreshing rain. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord, for all his love. He only is the maker of all things good and far. He paints the wayside flower, he lights the evening star. The wind and waves obey him, by him the birds are fed. Much more to us his children, he gives our daily
Send forth your strength, O God.
Establish what you have wrought in us.
Uphold all those who fall.
And raise up those who are bowed down.
Open the eyes of the blind and set the prisoners free.
Sustain the orphaned and the widowed and give food to those who hunger.
Grant them the joy of your help again.
And sustain them with your spirit.
Giver of peace, judge of peoples.
And take all nations for your own.
In our prayers this evening, in the Anglican Communion, we pray for the new province of Alexandria. In the Anglican Church of Canada, we pray for the Diocese of Capel, the Right Reverend Robert Hardwick, their bishop. In the Council of the North, we pray for the fall meeting of the Council of the North, the Right Reverend William Cliff, their chair. In our own diocese, the Diocese of Edmonton, we pray for Christ Church Edmonton, Susan Oliver, their rector, Chelsea Bowman, the associate priest. In the Bouye Diocese, we pray for Kabondi Parish, Sergius Rossa, the rector. We also pray for the Anak Cree Nation. We continue to pray for Burundi and our twin parishes, Kibanga and St. Luke's Bogombo. We also pray for the Canadian Armed Forces serving at home and abroad.
Continue, we are going to move into, as the song alludes to us, actually it's both songs that we've just sung had to, thankfulness. And Lammas Day, one of the things that we do is we present bread made with the first wheat that has been harvested. And for those of us in Canada, we recognize that our wheat isn't yet ready to harvest. Part of the tradition was set before the change of the calendar, so we're out 12 days for harvest, and we would maybe better see it if we took the part of this song that talks about first the blade and then the ear and understand it in the terms of corn, which of course we harvest earlier than we do wheat. The other aspect of Lammas Day is first fruits, the first fruits of our garden, and we come and we offer those first fruits, the best of those first fruits, to God. And so there's this sense of offertory and thanksgiving for the provision of food. So if you're feeling a disconnect that it isn't quite harvest time and we're singing harvest songs, in some ways it is harvest time, and we give thanks to God for the bounty that is supplied to us throughout the growing season. So let us give thanks to God, the God of all the peoples of the earth, for the color and forms of your creation.
In our place within us, within it,
we bring our thanks good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
For our daily food and for those whose work, for our daily food.
And for those whose work and skill bring your good gifts to us.
We bring our thanks, good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
For the gifts and graces inspired in human minds and hearts.
For insight and imagination, for the skills of research which bring healing and fulfillment to the lives of many.
We bring our thanks, good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
For the light and shades of the changing seasons and their variety and dependability.
For new life and growth out of the barrenness and decay.
We bring our thanks, good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
For new hope and strength in our communities.
Especially in your church and among all who call to serve you.
We bring our thanks, good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
For all in whose lives we see goodness, kindness, gentleness, patience, and humility.
And all the fruit of the Spirit.
We bring our thanks, good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
For the life we've been given and for all those whom you've given us to share it. I did it again, didn't I? For all the life we have been given.
And for all those whom you have given us to share it.
We bring our thanks, good Lord.
Your mercy endures forever.
Eternal God, you crown the year with your goodness, and you give us the fruits of the earth in their season.
Grant that we may use them to your glory and the relief of those in need, and for your own well-being through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Trusting in the compassion of God and gathering our prayers and praises into one, let us pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. And our final hymn is All Things Bright and Beautiful.
All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, Lord God gave them all. Each little flower that opens, each little bird that sings, He made the glowing colors, He made their tiny wings. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The purple-headed mountains, the river running by, the sunset and the morning that brightens up the sky. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. The cold wind in the winter, wonderful, the Lord God made them all.
And just before we end, I have one last thing that I need to give thanks for. And that is, on Sunday, Owen and I celebrated 40 years of marriage. And so I give thanks to God for 40 years and 4 children and 4 grandchildren. We've been richly blessed, and it just seems appropriate that a time of Thanksgiving, that our wedding was around a time of Thanksgiving, so that each year when our anniversary comes up, it is at a normal time of Thanksgiving, and it is something that I give great thanks for. So I'll allow you to dismiss.
Tend the earth, care for God's good creation, and bring forth the fruits of righteousness. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Go now in peace. Go now in peace. May the love of God surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go.
Go now in peace, go now in peace.
May the love of God surround you. May the love of God surround you.
Go now in peace. Go now in peace. May the love of God surround you.
May the love of God surround you.